All right, we'll just wait for everyone to come back in while they're getting ready. You know, the longer they take, the more jokes I'm going to do. So, it's all coming from the top of my head. So you probably have a gauge of what's going on in my mind. But, so I'll tell you this joke, right? There's this man, and he's still working through his, he's a work in progress. So he has a habit of pinching stuff, yeah? So he would go to the supermarket and he, would pinch some canned food, yeah? Canned food. And so he went to the supermarket, and he pinched 4 cans of food. And he got caught. Can you believe it? He got caught. And when he got caught, he had to go to a judge, in front of a judge. And the judge looked at the canned food and said, "Man, you know, why are you stealing canned food, right? You got to break this habit. So in order for you to remember this, to break this habit, for every single canned food, you're going to spend 1 week in jail." So he stole 4 canned food. So, of course, you know, he has to spend 4 weeks in jail. And then his wife suddenly put her hand up and said, "Your Honor, he also stole a bag of peas." All right, it'll take you a while to get it. But while everyone's coming back, I hope you're doing well, and I hope that you're having a fantastic time. And as we are getting people back, we're hoping that, you'll continue to be blessed by the service so far, and by the things that have been shared today. How many people here are quite blessed? Oh, great. Fantastic, fantastic. Well, as we are getting more and more people back, I think Anthony's asked me to pass this lettuce, okay? To pass this lettuce to the winner. So I think Anthony's going to still praying about it. He's still working out, all right, who's going to win this. But I think he's also already given me a name, all right? So I'm waiting for that person to be here to get this lettuce, okay? So while that's happening, maybe what you can do is, you know, after you eat, I remember someone told me this joke one time, right? That, you know, the two strings that attaches your stomach to your eyelids, yeah? So as your stomach gets heavier and heavier, the string pulls on your eyelid. And so, you know, your eyes start to close. So maybe I'll ask you all to stand and just stretch your, you know, stretch a little bit, stretch your arms, stretch your feet and all that, just to, you know, get a bit of blood moving, you know, because, you know, we're sitting down having a bit of food. Now, while you are standing up as well, I'd like you to form groups of 4, okay? Groups of 4 or 5, you know, just form small groups. Preferably, not all the pastors and leaders join the same group, yeah?
Oh.
So it'll be good if the pastors or the leaders can join different groups, okay? Because guess what? We're going to do a trivia, okay? We're going to do a trivia, all right? So can I ask you all to form groups of 4 or 5 or whatever? Now, if you're smart, you know, if you're smart and you know that we're in a church, right? You would really want someone who is very knowledgeable. Someone who's very knowledgeable about the Bible, all right? You want someone who's very knowledgeable about the Bible. So if anyone is in your group that's not very knowledgeable about the Bible, you have the permission to ask them to migrate to another group. Only kidding,
don't
only kidding.
Away. Don't send, you know, me away.
We're all work in progress here. You know, we're all in the house of God. All right, now that you've got your group, all right, now that you've got your group, in your group, if you're not as have a group, just join one, okay? I'm going to ask you all to pick one leader, okay, or one person. Now that person needs to have a smartphone, okay? Can I have the first slide?
Okay,
so
if you're
one of those persons that, you know, decided to go back in time and switch your phone, you know, so that person has to have a smartphone, and that smartphone has to be able to scan a QR code, okay? scan a QR code, yeah? All right, you have to be able to scan a QR code. So if your phone, your smartphone, is not able to scan a QR code, then you can't really use it, okay? All right, so we're going to do a bit of a trivia. Now, you've got a name, give a name to your group. So can you decide on a group name, yeah? Your group name can be Benjamin, Impact, anything. Just give yourself a group name, okay?
Yeah.
Now, in a few minutes, I'm actually going to put the QR code for the trivia that you're doing, okay? All right, now I won't do that now. I'm going to explain the rules, okay? All right, the first rule is, the first question is that you got to put your group name. So don't put your group name too long, all right? Because there's going to be a time limit. That's the first thing. The second thing is, because of technology, all right? Because of technology, unfortunately, the answers has to be correct. So for example, if the answer is Jesus, you know, you can't not spell the word Jesus incorrectly. You have to spell the word Jesus correct, right? And it has to be in English as well, right? My coding doesn't work up to, doesn't translate. It has to be English, right? So, you know, it has to be Jesus. If the answer is Jesus, it has to be J-E-S-U-S, right? In English, right? And the other thing as well is the first letter, unfortunately, has to be in capitals, okay? So the first letter of, say, for example, the answer is Jesus. The first letter has to be a capital J, okay? That's how the coding works. So those are just the rule. If you haven't got a group yet, just form a group and get a smartphone ready. All right, now each group can only have one person to be the person to scan the QR code, all right, and do the trivia. All right, so are we all ready? Is everyone clear of the rules? Yeah, all here? All right, now you've got, because we're running out of time, you've got 3 minutes, okay? So one group could only do one question. Can I have the QR code on the screen, please? Oh, good, all right, let's start. All right, you've got 5 minutes now. You've got 5 minutes to answer the questions, okay? So make sure. Hey, the other thing as well is please do not use Google, all right? Do not use Google to find the answer. Please do not use Google to find the answer, all right? So I am going to now try to get the answer, all right? Now guys, think carefully, all right? Think carefully, all right? Yeah, each group can only submit one answer, all right? Now, make sure that you do all the questions and do not hit the submit button until you're ready or sure of the answer, all right? Alright, how many groups do we have here? One group, two groups, three groups, four, five, six, seven. Seven groups, alright. Alright, is that the timer? Alright. Okay guys, I'm going to put my timer here. You've got 2 minutes to submit the answers, okay? All right, where's my timer? Timer. 2 minutes, yeah? All right, 2 minutes to submit the answer, all right? Remember, no using Google. You guys wouldn't do that, right? You wouldn't cheat, right? We are in church after all, yeah? Thank you. All right, one group has already submitted the answers. All right, one group's already submitted the answers. Oh, two groups have submitted the answers. Two groups already. All right, how many groups are there? One, two, three, yep, four, five, six. I think there's seven groups, yeah?
Right.
All right, you've got 36 seconds to submit the answers.
All the way through.
36 seconds, all right? Once you submit, they should let you know how many points you've got, okay? All right, three groups submitted the answers. Three groups submitted the answers. Who else is yet to submit your answers? Everyone submit the answers? All right, let's do the countdown. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, everyone stop. All right, who hasn't submitted the answers? Submit your answers, please. Why not? Oh. I can't give you the answers. Everyone, you got to submit your answers. All right. So, there are seven. All right, we're just waiting for one more group. All right, let's see. I've got to look at the answers. Okay, which group got 4 out of 10? Yeah. Which group got more than that? Who's got more than 4 out of 10? Yeah, one group. All right. Really? So everyone else got less than 4? Because you should already have the answers, right? Oh, your score, yeah? All right, I thought I was going to do a lightning round. Okay, all right, so which group? All right, so which group got less than 4 out of 10? Yeah, everyone, all right. So most groups have, all right, so this group is obviously the winner. Yay! Let's give them a round of applause. And what's your group name? Ask Google, all right. Hey guys, let's give Ask Google a round of applause. Well done. Well done, everyone, for being so sportsmanlike. Now that I know you had a fantastic lunch and, of course, your brain or your cranium is starting to work again, why don't we take our seats once again? And I guess without further ado, we're going to invite a very, very special speaker for today, all right, who's ready. And I know that he's got something bursting out of his heart and bursting out of his mind as well to really share a powerful message for us today. He's none other than my special friend, Pastor Mark. Let's all stand and give him a round of applause, eh?
Praise the Lord. Can you hold that thing? Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Praise the Lord. Hey, what if we just worship God? We just sing one praise song. Wes got that ready for us. You know, one of the things we need to realize that the times are very difficult that we are in right now, and yet the absolute paradox is that it's actually during these times that it's times of harvest. Amen. And that's the joy that we have to participate in the harvest. So let's just worship God and thank Him. These are days of harvest. Let's go, Wes. Days of Elijah.
Let's do Days of Elijah.
Let's all stand, yeah?
Key of C. Does anyone know this song?
And these are days of
Lord, that you are with us today and we have an opportunity to hear your word. And we pray that you'll speak to our hearts and encourage us and even impart something, Lord. Impart fresh faith, fresh fire for your work. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. So today I want to talk a little bit about salt and light ministry. And definitely, you know, when Jesus said, "You're the light of the world," he's talking about bringing some serious impact into the world. Amen. You know what's really interesting about that, that passage when he says, "You are the light of the world," and build in, and bear in mind, he didn't start that way. He said, "Blessed are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom." He gave eight things that relate to kingdom living. Then he finished and he said, you are, not just anybody, but you are the light of the world. When you understand the kingdom, understand kingly authority, my authority, you're going to become a light to the world. You know what's interesting? It says, he says this, he says, no one would light, no, you're a city on a hill, you can't be hidden, right? That's you, amen? That's you, that's me. When we understand those things. But then he said this, he said, no one lights a lamp and hides it under a bowl. Who would do that, right? So once you're lit, once you understand the gospel, once you understand Christ in you, you are absolutely positioned to be a light. But you know what's interesting? He said, let this light shine before all men, that they may know what? They may glorify your Father in heaven. They may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. You know what's interesting? And the Holy Spirit prompted me just now as we were worshiping. That is the first time there's the implication of sonship in the Bible. In the book of Matthew. And isn't it interesting that when we glorify him as sons and daughters, it comes in the context of being a light to the world. Who said amen to that? And I'll tell you something. I'm here to help us by, I want to impart something to us, right? Because one thing I've learned about salt and light ministry is God wants to put the light in a lampstand. Understand that today. Jesus never intended for us to be, you know, at the feet of someone, or, you know, to be hidden under a bowl. To be hidden under a bowl and out of sight, out of mind. God has a lampstand for us so that men will glorify our Father in heaven. Isn't that great news? And I'll tell you something, it doesn't matter who you are, God is saying you can be the light to the world, but provided, you know, we understand those foundations. And I want to say this, my life has been interesting. I've been formally appointed as a church leader, as a pastor, really, from around 2002. I started more formally, though. I went a long way back as a missionary, as far back as 1990 to Indonesia, and had been doing a lot of things. But I was formally appointed as in our family, our church family at that time. And what was interesting for me was I journeyed. This is my salt and light journey. I was very keen to disciple people in the church, very focused on church life. Those that came under my pastorship, you would know that I was very dogged in that, very dogged. But one thing that came to a point in my life, I felt that God was doing a new thing, and I felt that I was too focused in the church, and the Lord wanted me to look outside the church a little bit more. I know it says, he said, go into all the world, but for my journey, I need to do something that allowed me to come out of my cocoon. And God started to stir my heart to use my art. Cut a long story short, I became a best-selling author and started being invited to Dimox, you know, in places like Dimox, Camberwell. I remember this was in 2013. You know, the person who came and spoke the week after me was John Howard. And it blew my mind that God could take me out of this insignificant place and then launch me as an artist, as an author. And I wrote a book called Iconic Melbourne. And that was the beginning of many things. That allowed me to then become more salt and light, like a motivational speaker in all kinds of organizations and places. And then in 2017, I started a ministry in our church. We call it the Mountain Mover Ministry. So we want to move mountains. We want to impact society for God and be that salt and light. So that's been my journey. And one thing I can tell you, I've seen in that journey, I've seen many people get released into the arts and entertainment, media, government, and these different realms, because God wants a light in those realms. He doesn't want darkness to prevail. The only way to dispel darkness is to switch on the light. So God's plan is not darkness, but it's light. So He's got a lampstand for you. I just want to start and say this, though, prophetically today, I prayed for us all today. So what is like a thing that God wants to do that you should keep in mind? And that is, I saw a vision of, if we go to the first slide, that'd be great, city on a hill. I felt the Lord just say, there's a lot of pharaohs at the moment that are not having much sleep. You know the story of Joseph when Pharaoh couldn't sleep and the Nile appeared to be in a famine situation? And, you know, there's those things happening. And Joseph had a word for him. The Bible says he brought the answer of peace. I just sense there's a... right now, some of our managers... Some of our leading politicians, some people in all kinds of industries across the world, who would agree, it is such an unsettling time. Supply chains have gone missing. There's such instability with the economy. Everything's being thrown about. But friends, I want to encourage you. God is saying that He's raising up a company of Josephs in this season. Do I hear an amen? I'd be prophetically... I believe God is just saying, I want you to be that person that will come to your senior management, or that person. Like Joseph, he didn't just touch the king, the Pharaoh, but he touched people at all levels. Do I hear an amen? And I feel the Lord saying that there's that aching cry within people's hearts at the moment to find something solid, a rock of dependency, and He's put you there. And so hear what I'm saying today, because I believe these are the keys. There's real key to being a light in this season. Do I hear an amen? And I want to say one last thing, you know, in terms of making an impact like this. I got this word I'm going to share about. If you've read the story, probably many of us heard this story. I've certainly read it many times, but got a fresh insight into it. 1 Samuel 14. Jonathan climbs up the cliff and he is able to, you know, he was able to bring about a great rippling effect there as he impacted, you know, the Philistine army as just like a sole ranger, a lone ranger. And I feel the Lord wants to highlight something in there. It's really important for us. But I got this word, it's been burning in my heart for 2.5 months. And since that time, I have had 3 really powerful confirmations on this word. So I'm not just going to share some words of the Lord, the theory of it, but I'm going to give you some practical too. Do I hear an amen? How does it actually look? Because these are things that actually happen. I know they happen because the word was given. And so I pray they'll speak to us as well. So we go to the next slide. I want to title it, this is the word of the Lord for us, finding faith to make an impact. Do I hear an amen? Faith is the victory that overcomes the world, the Bible says. Finding faith to make an impact. But particularly, I want to talk about cliff-hugging faith. Can you do this with me? Look a bit silly for a moment. Start climbing the cliff, right? Do it prophetically, right? Climbing the cliff. Jonathan climbed up the cliff and they were waiting for him up top, right, in this story. And so I want to say finding faith. Why are we finding faith? Truth is, the Lord prompted me on this. Ephesians 2:8 says, it is by grace you have been saved through faith, right? And this is not of yourselves, but it is the gift of God. So everything, I believe this, everything we needed as a Christian and for life as a Christian, the faith that is, not the understanding associated with it, but the raw faith to be able to trust him, there is a measure of faith that we already received when we were born again. Do I hear an amen? It's interesting, it says, add to your faith knowledge and virtue and self-control, but it doesn't say add faith. It just says add to faith. Faith we have. We have been born again with the divine nature, but we need to be renewed. Okay, but I want to talk about cliff-hugging faith. Who's with me today? Cliff-hugging, right? That is the faith that will make an impact. All right, let's go to the scripture now. The first thing I want to say is finding faith through hearing, okay? Finding faith through hearing, right? Let's look at the scripture now. We'll read it to you. Jonathan said to his armor bearer, let's go over to the other side, to the outpost. Perhaps the Lord will act on our behalf. Nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or few. And then in verse 7, his armor bearer said, do all you have in mind, his armor bearer said. Go ahead, I am with you, heart and soul. And then in verse 2 it says, Saul was staying in the outskirts of Gibeah under a pomegranate tree in Migron, place of oblivion, in the middle of nowhere, right? With him around 600 men, among them was Ahijah, the son of Ichabod's brother. So you look at Jonathan. Jonathan is initiating. Jonathan is not defined by his circumstances. Did you hear that? He is able, as a lone ranger with his able armor bearer, to go into a camp against the odds, right? And bring it to them. And while Saul, on the other hand, is doing what? Where's Saul? He's under the pomegranate tree in Migron, kind of in the middle of nowhere, languishing, not doing anything. It's amazing the difference faith can make in our life when we have faith. And then the next scripture, we could go to the next part. Look, said the Philistines. So he attacks the camp. He attacks the outpost of the Philistines. The Hebrews are crawling out of their holes they were hiding in. Jonathan climbed up using his hands and feet. I mean, he couldn't even barely hold a sword somehow. He's climbing up this cliff face, right? And it says, in his first attack, he killed some 20 men, and the panic struck the whole army and those in the field, in the camp and field. The ground shook. It was a panic sent by God. So his faith was amazing. He crawled out of the hole. You know, sometimes we as Christians, right, we've got to get out of the hole. We haven't been seen by a lot of people. We've been hiding. His faith is such that he goes up the mountain and his faith attracts this powerful God intervention. Why? Because he's seeking God. On the other hand, look at Saul. In verse 18, Saul said to Ahijah, bring the Ark of God. He wanted to capitalize on this move. He could see the Philistines fading away in turmult. It says, the turmult, the Philistine camp increased more and more. And so Saul said to the priest, withdraw your hand. So one man is seeking God and asking. The other one says, withdraw your hand. He doesn't want to receive divine guidance. He got no time for divine guidance. And nothing much happens. But he rides on the back of what Jonathan did and because of his faith. Let me just illustrate two things that I get from this that are very important right now. Firstly, faith comes by hearing, right? Jonathan, his arm bearer, leaves the camp. There's no support. They climb up a cliff to attack. Why? Faith comes by hearing the message, and hearing comes by the Word of God, Romans 10:17. He heard God. What did he hear? He heard, perhaps the Lord will act on our behalf. Amen? Perhaps the Lord will act on our behalf. Nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by few or many. He had a tremendous sense of hope in his spirit. He saw possibility. He knew that it was possible to actually do this. It was a spring in his step, so to speak. He was really able to launch in and do this. Why? Because he heard from God. Friends, I want to encourage you, stepping out is possible, whether there's few or many around us. Whether it is little, we have little, or we have much. Amen? It's not about me. But I want to say this. My next point is, faith and hearing is of sons. Do I hear an amen? Faith and hearing is of sons. Who hears in the Bible? My sheep hear my voice. Who hears in the Word of God? The sons hear. The sons hear the Father's voice. Do I hear an amen? You see, when we are able to have a faith that clings to God in this way, Romans 5:1 talks about a faith that taps into God's grace and God's divine enabling. And that faith that makes us alive is when we're connected into the fullness of Christ and who He is. The Bible says in Colossians 2, I think it's verse 8, you know, for in Him the fullness of the deity dwells in bodily form, and you have been given fullness in Him. Hallelujah! Oh, you've been given fullness in Him. So when you have the fullness of God's love, and straight after that it says, and in Him, He is the head of every principality and power. When it's revelational knowledge, you realize that you don't have to be afraid of people. You can walk as a son. Amen? You're like a ballistic missile that the Lord launches and He guides you to the target. Hallelujah. I want to be that son. Friends, that is the provision of God. To all who believed Him, He gave them the permission to become the sons of God. The Bible says, for all who are baptized in Christ have clothed themselves with Christ. Amen. John, I believe, is a type of Christ. He's not just a great guy. I believe prophetically, Jonathan is absolutely speaking to us of Christ Himself. You know, it's a picture of who we can be in Him. Amen. It's an invitation into inheritance, that scripture for us. He's a type of Christ. What did Christ do? He heard the Father. In John 5 and verse 19, the Son can do nothing by Himself, but He can only do what He sees His Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son does also. So friends, I want to encourage you, when we hear the Lord speak and start to maneuver us, we walk in faith and in hearing Him, and we can do that because we have the fullness of Christ. Everybody that believes in Christ has received His fullness, and all we need to do is to understand that we don't have to be defined by circumstances, but we are defined by Christ and what He has done. Do I hear an amen? Right? We are not defined. See, Jonathan was not defined by his father. Who would agree? Our father has tremendous influence over our life. He was not defined by that. He was not defined by his father, Saul. He was, you know, it's interesting. It says that Ichabod was in Saul's camp, and also the remnant of Eli's Phinehas, you know, the son of Phinehas as well. If you look back in the Word of God, you see that Phinehas, you know, he held the ark up and he was killed in battle. He was living in a life of sinful lifestyle, wasn't walking with God. This remnant, this residual thing is there, this reminder. Saul's walking in that kind of company. Ichabod, what is Ichabod? Remember, I think it's 1 First Samuel, somewhere about 4 or so, 4 or 5, and you see how Ichabod means the glory has departed. See, Saul's in dire straits here. 1 Samuel 13, you see, the situation was critical. They lost a lot of men. They're losing men. They're hemorrhaging. His father is in a bad way. He's really bitter towards God. He's bent on doing his own thing. What an example to have. Sometimes we don't have the best examples in our life. But I want to say something. When we walk in this kind of faith, it will not affect or corrode our ability to walk as sons. Do I hear an amen? We're not defined by our father's failings. We're not defined by the place where we stay, the places of insignificance like Migron. We're not defined by what our peers do. You know, he initiates despite inactivity, despite no leadership. We're not defined by what we have or do not have. They only had 2 swords in the camp. The Philistines had monopolized all the equipment. All the military might was in their hand. He was not defined by that. Faith taps into that sonship. Amen. Faith taps into that glory realm. And friends, faith is the victory. And not only that, faith retracts the favor and the power of God. Why did the armor bearer say, "I am with you, heart and soul"? Because the power of God was flowing through him as he walked in this great faith. I believe it's a major key to enabling discipleship to occur as well. Amen. Who would like to see more people saying, "I'm with you, heart and soul," as compared to making an appointment and they never show up? Who's been frustrated by that? Get more of the power. And grow. We need to grow in our faith. Amen. What are some action points with this? Just a couple of action points. The first thing we can learn is, are we repenting? The 4 R's. Repenting at Migron. Repent. That's the first R. You know, I think Saul should have looked at what was happening through his son's life and said, "Wow, he's doing something right." He should have looked at David when they said, Saul has won his thousands, David his tens of thousands. He should have started looking at his own heart and saying, "God, what's missing? What's going on?" You know, when God gives victory, God gives blessing to others, we shouldn't be envious. We should be asking ourselves, why? Why is Bethel so, you know, incredibly influential in the marketplace today? You see extraordinary tests. Why is that? And, you know, for example, I'm not highlighting any particular group, but I'm just saying, why? Why? You know, what is there to learn for us? And I say we've got to repent from Migron. I was preparing this sermon. I was out front of a bag shop this week. I was sitting in front of a shop where a lady sold bags, and I was watching her sell the bags. I watched for the first hour. No one came in, not even one person. The second hour, just one person. They looked at a bag and then they walked straight out. I'll tell you, I was feeling embarrassed for that poor lady trying to sell those bags. And isn't that just like Saul sitting under the pomegranate tree in Migron? You know, just alone, feeling defeated, frustrated, afraid. Migron, by the way, means precipice or place of fear. He was stuck there. Can I praise God? God never intended for Saul to stay there. God wanted Saul to be a great king. Do I hear an amen? God doesn't want us to stay in the place of inactivity. We have a choice today, even as you hear this word. You know, I don't want to be in Migron anymore. It's not about whether you work in a bag shop or it doesn't matter what you do. Who would agree? It can get very monotonous and boring with what we do sometimes. I'll tell you something. Nothing adds excitement and joy more than knowing we can be a part of God's plan. Amen? I had a call from Theo this week. He contacted me. He said, you know, he's working long hours in a hospital and doing it pretty hard. But he said, you know, this week I had a chance to pray for one of my patients and minister to her. And he just said, "I just had such a joy, despite all the stuff I'm going through." He's not in Migron. He's over here in. He's reaching up. He's got cliff-hugging faith. Amen? He knows why he's there. He's not just there to be in a hospital working there. He knows that he's there for the Lord's work. Do I hear an amen? Another thing, we've got to rely on the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Practice them. I'll tell you something. It's so important to be filled with the Spirit and move in spiritual gifts. The reason why the church can hear great sermons but there's little activity is because often people don't know how to steward their spiritual gift. When you learn, if you're trained how to move in that prophetic gift and walk, because once you're moving in that power, in that way, you're like the tram here in Melbourne that has the power line above. You always got power when you're on the track. When you're led of the Spirit, where there's a freedom at work in the house where you can be led of the Spirit, I'll tell you something. We walk in that power. I've seen people over the years in television and some of these areas. Why are they so powerful? They're reaching souls in these very hard to get to places. Why? Because of stewarding the gifts of the Spirit. Amen? And understanding it. In Acts 19 verse 6, Paul laid hands on them. What did they do? They prophesied. He said, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? They said, no, we've not even heard there's a Holy Spirit. Then what baptism? He got them baptized. They spoke in tongues and they prophesied liberally. There was no trying to can it or thwart it. It was the Lord releasing fullness onto them. And after that, you see later on, it says, in this way, the word of the Lord spread throughout the province of Asia. Amen? Get people into that place. Pastor Matthew was sharing about it before, how he touched by the baptism of God's love. Very important as a foundation. We're going to have the power of God working through us right now to shine. That's how Jesus shined. Amen? We see in Matthew 25, it's so imperative right now. It's imperative that we operate like this. At that time, the kingdom of heaven shall be like 5-10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish, right? The ones need to realize you've got to pay the price to get that oil. That's why to catch a fresh anointing. I just went to Arnhem Land a couple of weeks back. I was involved in a conference there. And I came back with a beautiful overflow of the Holy Spirit because I was led of the Lord to go there, and you know, wonderful leaders like Brother Dara and others were supportive for me to go up, and I just saw amazing things. And I praise God for our Indigenous brothers over there. We got to catch a fresh anointing, amen. But not only that, it's got to infiltrate. It's got to go beyond just moving in the church. We've got to develop the vocab, the prophetic vocab as well, to start prophesying about market shares and other things too. You know, expand. Amen. Let that anointing capture your whole life. That's what I think we need to do. Because God wants to release the prophetic voice like Daniel in this hour. That's why the gifts are so imperative as a foundation. But it's just the beginning. You then, Timothy, my son, be strong in the grace. Once you have that grace, now the four generations of discipleship, not an issue. The issue is, are you strong in the grace? That's where we got to start. Amen? I want to say one more thing about this. Malachi 4, 5 and 6. See, I will send the prophet Elijah in those days. He will knit the hearts of the children to the fathers. Right? We see the intergenerational gap sometimes, right? Why Elijah? Why was Elijah sent? Elijah was the one who called down the fire. And Elijah was the one who said, if the Lord is God, then follow him. Amen? If he's God, then follow him. He authenticated. He authenticated the reality of the kingdom. And there's something about that power that will make it easy for us to raise up the next generation. Do I hear an amen? Now, I just want to share a quick story. I only got 2 points. That's okay. So hopefully I won't go over a little. I'll keep on time. Okay, here's an experience that I had last month. I've been helping to encourage the Mountain Movers, that Mountain Move group. a lot of these people really want to reach out as well. And so thank God for our church. It's been encouraging, this Mountain Move of Spirit, Salt and Light Ministry. And anyway, one of our Mountain Movers asked me, one of the ones I've been discipling, asked me to pray for their business that was being launched. Pray for their business. And so it was no little thing, because my friend asked me to go there with his CEO, and also the other person that's been involved is a former US senator. So I had to go as a group of people to pray for this business, and I learned more about the business, okay? The business has about 8% market share nationally, okay? So not a little tiny business. Got 100 shops throughout the country. And I was asked to pray for it. Just pray for it. Pray a blessing over it. And at first I was excited. I shared with, you know, Pastor Matt, and he said, oh, that sounds like a good opportunity for the Lord, so he encouraged me to go. And anyway, I was praying about the word of the Lord. How do I pray? I was thinking to myself, how am I going to pray? I'm just going to pray, God, I bless this business in Jesus' name, amen. And I was just really going through my mind, how do I pray for the business? And so I found something in the financial, there was an article in the Financial Review, and it was, it said that the CEO said, we've got 8.5% market share for the country, and he said by 2035 they're believing for 15% market share. So I read that, and I was just seeking God about it. And then I felt the Holy Spirit speak to me and say, tell him that God wants to give him 30%. It's too low a goal. It's not 15%, 30% market share. In other words, it's double. I heard the Lord say, double portion. Now, it all sounds good, right? Anyway, I got there, and we were at a hotel. There was a few hundred sales staff for the thing. That was the first thing. It's very intimidating. It's like Philistines everywhere. You know, it's like, oh. And then the CEO said, I really need to see you, right? I heard that you're going to pray for something. He's very obnoxious. Oh, well, you know, very straight in the way he talked. He really wanted to sort me out and say, is he a flaky sort of nut, religious nut? Nobody prays for things anymore. But in respect for the person, our friend who put me there to pray, he listened to me, and I had two HR people grill me for about 5 minutes about what I was going to pray for. And I can tell you, it was intimidating. I was really feeling the juices begin to flow. Who's felt like that before? I mean, you're not doing this for anything except to just raise the Lord's banner, but I can tell you the pressure is immense. The pressure's immense. And then later on, the conference was moving very quickly at a fast pace. You know, everyone wanted to get their word in. And so there was not much time. And then, you know, I felt squeezed. I felt really squeezed. How am I going to do this in a way that honors the Lord? And I remember just really feeling intimidated. But at the last moment, you know what really helped me? Firstly, my wife was there typing Bible scriptures right next to me. Scripture after scripture, which was fantastic. I used them all in my prayer. The second thing was, Sister Hynie had been interceding. She had a prophetic word for me many weeks before, and it meant nothing at all. Lion of the tribe of Judah, strategically in position. Meant nothing, you know. I just thought, oh, okay, it's nice. You know, it's a good word. But then, when my heart was starting to beat, I realized, lion of the tribe of Judah, you're a lion. When you pray, you roar! You roar! And I did. And I said to them all, look, in the spirit of collaboration with Indigenous people, I believe God wants to release a double portion of blessing here. And I said, not just 15, but 30%. And all these tough dudes, all these tough, you know, sales managers around the country looked at me and the look, you know, could cut through your being, you know, really. And then I prayed with all my heart. I said, in the name of Jesus, I loose 30% market share. And you know what happened? As I was praying like that, the CEO said, yes! Screamed. He was so pumped. He was so happy. Afterwards, he came up to all of us, the CEO and you know, the former senator person, everyone. He came to me personally, he said, shook my hand, said, thank you so much. Because I can tell you right now, in industry, it is very, very shaky. It is very hard. We all know that. And they're all feeling the pinch. So the Lord told me, you know, pray for Babylon, because if Babylon prospers, you too will prosper. Jeremiah 29. So the point is, we can be a blessing through cliff-hugging faith. And I wonder all the people that heard that when I was praying. Imagine the people saying, hang on, he heard from God, market share going up to 30%. I mean, you know, can you hear from God? That was the design. There was some design in that too, to create a context for people to say, maybe I should be asking God things too. Amen? God's real. Who's with me here? Who wants cliff-hugging faith? Right? Cliff-hugging, right? Because once you move in that, God will open those things for us. Amen? He wants to. Quickly now, cliff-hugging faith. We need to find faith by heralding, right? Jonathan said to his armor-bearer, come. He said, come, let's go over to the outpost of those uncircumcised men. You know, a herald proclaims, you know, Vic Market, $1, $1, $1, $1, $1. A proclamation. There's teaching and there's preaching. I'm preaching right now. I'm proclaiming. Amen? It's proclaiming the word, right? The preaching of the word, okay? So $1, $1. Who's ever seen that before? It's great, isn't it? $1, $1. Gets your attention. So, you know, Paul was a herald of the gospel. The word herald means one that is under the king's official, he's officially authorized to declare a message. Amen? I believe Jonathan said this. He didn't just say, come, let's go over. He said, come, let's go over to those uncircumcised Philistines. It was not just a little, you know, it was heralding. Amen? Powerful. Friends, when we find faith by knowing the gospel, we will become heralds of the gospel. It's not just imitating a form. It's when we understand the substance of the gospel that we will be emboldened like Paul. He said, uncircumcised. What is that? It's typifying the old covenant. You know, in Genesis 17, God said, anyone who is not circumcised shall not be a part of my covenant. We know in Colossians chapter 2, it talks about being circumcised, putting off the old sinful nature, removing the sin. Amen? That's the picture of circumcision. It's also the seal of righteousness. Amen? Genesis 15. So we see that he's a herald. He's a herald of these things. Let's go over. He's walking in that authority. He knows they're not circumcised. They're not in covenant with God. I am. And so Jonathan climbed up, verse 13, using his hands and feet, the armbearer right behind him. And the Philistines fell before Jonathan, and his armbearer followed and killed behind him, killed some 20 men. Do we kill people today? No, we don't. Amen. In the old covenant, it's a picture of God's justice and judgment on idolaters that don't repent, right? And so it's the sword of judgment in a way in the Old Testament. God's showing that we need to get serious. God's manifesting his justice. New covenant, we carry the sword of the Spirit. Do I hear an amen? Exodus 28, 38, it says 3,000 people died when they slew each other in the camp. They didn't obey God. But in Pentecost, how many got saved? 3,000. 3,000 put to death the old sinful nature and rose in the glorious new nature of Jesus Christ. Amen? And so what we see is a picture of a new covenant. See, Peter wanted to cut off ears. Jesus said, no, you haven't got it. You've got to understand it's a new way, okay? It's a way of love, amen? And so I really like that. We've got to understand as a herald what covenant we are a part of. So they went into battle. They found the Philistines in total confusion, striking each other. They were divided and they fought each other. Friends, it was interesting who would agree on that note of you create division. Jesus said, do not think I came to bring peace in the world, but rather division. And, we've got to understand the context with which he said that. But who would agree, you think of Scott Morrison recently when he was at Margaret Court's church and he was sharing about mental health and it created tremors in the nation, didn't it? Did you see that news coverage going out? Because he's got the audacity to link mental health and mental health and how to tackle it and the big problem of mental health in this country. And then he tags on, he says, by the way, the only way to really overcome this is through faith in Jesus Christ. I saw so many articles trying to hammer him because of that. Bless him. Amen. I love the way he said, I may not be the prime minister anymore, but I'm not down and out. You know, I'm the son of the living God. You know, I'm a child of God. He was preaching. Friends, I want to encourage us. We need to say things at times that are going to cause a polarization of two camps. We're going to speak the truth. Amen. In love. But it will cause people to say, is it right or is it wrong? 7 people don't wear a Guernsey, for example. And the whole nation's sort of polarized, divided over that. I'm not saying do that or don't do that. You do what you think in your heart God has told you to do. But the important thing is our actions can put people into a position where they need to choose. Amen? And we pray that those decisions will be for the Lord. And some of those things will cost. You know, it's costing some of these people right now. But they're going according to their conviction. You know, what's important is God wants to send a tremor. When he started hacking into that group, because he moved in that kind of faith, it brought people into a place they had to choose. You hear me? So one verse about Paul, he said, 1 Timothy 2:5, for there is one God, one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. This has now been witnessed at the proper time and is for this purpose. I was appointed as a herald to proclaim it and an apostle. I'm telling the truth. I'm not lying and am a true and faithful teacher to the Gentiles. Can I just give us a few practicalities on being a herald, right? Am I relevant and relational? The PM's talking about mental health. He's talking about depression, all those issues that everyone is facing. He's linking it to faith. There's a lot of doctors right now writing books that are doing PhDs based on not just the clinical pure wisdom of science, which is God's anyway, but also linking it to faith. Do I hear an amen? Whether you're a doctor or whether you're an architect, doesn't matter what realm you're in, everything has been somehow twisted in some way or another through the Babylonian culture that we're a part of. And we need to shine forth the godly culture. Salt means we're committed to God's culture. Do I hear an amen? And that's where the anointing is going to come in us when we are salt. We help. So salt was always given when they gave an offering in the Old Testament, they added salt. It was associated with commitment. Jesus said, have salt among yourselves, be at peace with one another, right? Saltiness leads to a commitment. It's about a commitment to godliness. Lot's wife turned to a pillar of salt, right? So when we have that, that's why salt first, then light. Salt, commitment, which is my next point. Not just relevance, we've got to be relevant to needs, but also righteousness, the righteousness of God, right? The righteousness of God, standing for the right things, not just mental health, but mental health based on the biblical paradigm. Probably 75% of people that go to hospital, I heard once, is not just because they're sick, but it's because spiritually they have not, you know, found forgiveness. There's bitterness. There's all kinds of other things that are causing that illness that are behind it. So anyway, I don't know all those things, but you're a doctor. If you're in the medical area, maybe God will lead you. That's how you build bridges with people, amen? Otherwise, you seem like someone highly religious and kind of spooky and mystical. Like, I can't relate to you. You don't talk about anything that I'm a part of. Like, you're not interested in sport. You're not interested in this. You're not interested in art. Anyway, I used to be like, you know, back in the day when I was discipling Matthew, back in that day, I never went to the National Gallery. I never went to the zoo, ever, ever. Now, my book has been in the zoo. I got a contact from the sales staff in the Melbourne Zoo. They want more copies of my book. It's been 8 years. 8 years. They still want the book. It's still in a premier position. The whole thing is written based on scripture, but it's put in a form that people can receive, and they like it. They like it. Do I hear an amen? Relevant righteousness of God, standing for what is right. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Am I sharing the gospel? Reaching out with the gospel. That's another R, reaching out. And one last thing, is God remolding me? We've got to understand, it's totally His work. It's not just the gifts of the Spirit, but it's the fruits of the Spirit. So when I went and came under the grill of, you know, the when I had to go to that big meeting to launch that business, it's the fruit of the Spirit. It's the fruit of the new life. It's the life, that love, that peace, that joy. I praise God for situations like that. If we have cliff-hugging faith, what I love about it is God actually raises, He builds us up like faith muscles, like pushing weights. He gives us another level of challenge so that we will rise up to it. Amen? It's not all bad. Praise the Lord. Here's a, recently, this is an example of heralding. Recently, my kindergarten, interestingly, where my kids do kinder, what happened was my children talked about my experience, my mission to Arnhem Land, and they're all excited about it. They're telling all the kids about it. So we and we have all these pictures throughout this kindergarten in the childcare of Indigenous people and all kinds of stuff about Indigenous people. So they really wanted, the kids talking about it, so they said, oh, wow, can we have all your photos? And so they got all my photos, some of the photos I took of my Arnhem Land experience. And then they said, oh, that's fantastic. And so I started to share to the main supervisor of all the miracles God did. I started just rattling them off. This miracle happened, this miracle. So, oh, wow. I never thought that. But I grew up in a Christian home. And, yes, it's amazing. So I was just passing on those photos and had a really good opportunity, quality witness to her. Anyway, I thought, that's going to sort her out. She's either for the Lord or she's not. You know, I want people to hear something. You know what I mean? I am serious about this. This is important to me. Right, so just think about that. That's really important. So anyway, the next day she said, I thought, I wonder if she's going to throw me out. You know, she goes, that was great what you shared. That was really good. And our manager has said, the manager of the center has said, we want you to preach to us now. We would like you to preach to us. I said, oh, great. Okay, I'm coming back. And they said, you, are also an artist. We'd like you to do an art workshop for the kids. I said, okay, I'll do it. I don't normally do something like that, you know, in a childcare, but I said, I'll do that for you. And so I had a little bit of time, and I really wasn't sure, what am I going to do for kids, you know, for that level, that age, like 5, 4 and 5, I thought, that's a bit... And so I felt, I thought, yeah, I'm going to share the gospel to the kids. Because I was talking with the kids, my kids, and they were just sharing, they gave me some ideas, helped me to coach me along. Anyway, this is what I gave him. Have a look at this. This is 1.5 meters by 90 centimeters. Can we see it? And we'll finish real soon. No, not this one, no. that's the Sistine Chapel, I think. So anyway, can you see that really fat koala? Right? Can you see that really fat koala who's taking all the leaves? And on the right-hand side, there's no leaves in all the trees. Right? On the left-hand side, there's koalas sharing. So on the right-hand side, they're kind of self-indulgent. This one's very self-indulgent. And so anyway, I shared with the kids, I just said to them, look, this koala always says, this is my tree, this is my tree, this is my tree, that's my tree, that's my tree. And he eats all the leaves, he just wants everything. That's why there's a desert over here. He's so greedy, he wants all of them. And then I said to all the kids, I said, who here sometimes says, that's my toy, that's my pencil, that's my sharpener. I don't know about you, but my kids do this all the time. It's like, it just happens every moment. And even the teacher said, I do a bit of that too. And so the wolf under there, see that wolf? The wolf is a relative of this koala. And he was so angry with the koala and screamed, you know, and roared at him. Should have been a dingo, obviously, but anyway. He roared, and then what happened as a result? It put the fear of God into this koala. And then afterwards, they all started to share. Why? Because this wolf laid down his life for his friends. And so there was some ranger involved as well who was wanting the land to be reborn and, you know, improved. And anyway, that is mine to sharing and caring. And we painted it as well. And so many of the people, the staff were touched and said, we never seen anything like, you know, just nothing like this. You know, this is really good. So I want to encourage you, you have your gift here. You have your gift. God wants to use your gift in your way. And it's very different. It would be very different to using the arts, but it could be in film and television, in business, in media, in all these areas. We can creatively proclaim the gospel, but we need, you know, His grace. Amen. We've got to realize who we are. We've got to have that cliff-hugging faith and realize that we are a herald. Amen. We're a herald. We're heralding. Once we really understand the good news, we will do it. And so that was a blessed, blessed time. Good for the kids too. The kids absolutely loved it. And now they're saying to me, Dad, I want you to paint this every weekend for me, for us. Okay, so praise the Lord. I want to finish right now. I want to finish by saying I believe the most important word in 1 Samuel 14 is this one word, the one major key. And the word is honey. Say it with me, honey. Why is honey the most important word in 1 Samuel 14? It said, after the battle, after they enjoyed the spoils, after Saul had actually told everyone, don't eat, let's just rip into the Philistines and destroy their army. They're in a weak and compromised position. He said that, right? And he bound everyone under an oath and he said, don't eat, but let's kill these Philistines. It was his personal vendetta, right? He's doing it for all the wrong reasons. He's doing it for his reason. It wasn't for the Lord. But what we see there is what we see though, why honey, right? Why honey? Because Jonathan was walking through the forest. He did not hear that oath of Saul, of his father. He didn't hear about that. He was not, I think there are two covenants there. It's covenant of law. Covenant of law, definitely, and covenant of grace. Covenant of grace was Jonathan putting his staff and taking the honey on the floor of the forest. And he ate the honey and his eyes glistened. His eyes glistened. Friends, we got to taste the sweetness of Jesus through all this, being salt and light. That's what really is so powerful, when we understand the sweetness of his love. Amen? You see, Saul's men who were bent on doing it for the wrong motive, how were they? They were tired. They were fainting. They were exhausted. Maybe you're feeling like that today. I want to tell you something. There's a new covenant, and the new covenant is about honey. It's about taste and see that the Lord is good. Amen? It's about walking in this cliff-hugging faith and realize that God's setting up a very dark backdrop right now so we can shine as light. I want to finish on one story. Is that all right? One last story. Okay, so I'll just share this week, right? Just 2 days ago, I got asked by my school to just help be a parent helper with the kids, to take them to the museum. Okay, so year nine kids. My kids, you know, my child's now year four, so year nines, we're just helping out with the year nines. And we've got to do community work for our school. So anyway, I just was a part of that. And I want to relate this to honey, okay? I was in the back. I remember I was at the very back just helping the kids, escorting the kids to the museum. And what happened was I started making conversation with one of the boys. It's probably around 14 or so. And I just said, how's things? And he's, I've been, you know, pretty tough. He dislocated his shoulder, so he was just sharing a bit. The kids are pretty timid, really. They didn't really want to talk to me, but somehow this kid was a bit open, and we chatted a bit. And then I said, so what do you want to be one day? He said, I want to be an engineer. I said, oh, really, engineer? He said, yeah, I'm really trying hard to do my maths. And I said, oh, actually, I studied engineering too. You know, when the Monash Medical Center was being built, I was there helping establish a building automation system. And it was a long time ago. And the senior project manager witnessed to me at that time, powerfully, as a Christian. That was a turning point in my life. Anyway, I was just sharing with this guy. I was saying, yeah, engineering's pretty tough. I'm not really practicing anymore, but it was really great when I was doing it. It was really great. And I said, you've got to persevere, don't you? Yeah, you've got to persevere. You've got to persevere in your mathematics. We talked a lot about perseverance. Anyway, we're getting closer to the museum. We're about to see the museum. There's the museum there on the left-hand side. We're almost to the museum. And I said, you know, another thing I do now is I'm an artist and I've also been an author. And, you know, a lot of people said to me, you'll never be able to draw. I don't know how many people told me when they saw my first drawings. They said, you know, You even your six-year-old niece could draw better than you. I mean, give up. Give up. Please do yourself a favor. And so I there's something in me that said I had to keep going with it and keep sketching here and there. You know, my wife's doing a little bit of shopping. I'm just sketching a little bit sometimes and just learning. And anyway, eventually in 2013, I wrote a book, I told him. And there's the book in the front window. We literally passed it. I said, see in that window there, the whole window was full of my books and my paintings and all that. He said, really? He said, that's phenomenal. I said, not just the front window, the rear window too. The front and rear window. And he said, I said, that's the power, I said, of perseverance. And then he was so into this conversation. He was so into it. And I said, but you know what the real key was to do it? He said, what? What was it? Tell me. I said, my wife prayed and I prayed about launching this book. My wife went into one room, I went in the other room, and looking for guidance. God, she got Isaiah 43, I got Isaiah 44. And I think there's 1,178 chapters in the Bible. Think about that. And so we got these two back-to-back ones. Isaiah 43 is, God will make a way. Isaiah 44 says, write it. So we did it in obedience. Said, I tell you, God, the God factor is the key. And he said, really? I pray to God every night. I've been praying for 2 years. And he said, the thing that I struggle with the most, I said this, someone gave me a prophetic word just this week, and I shared to him God loves you. God wants me to, I want to tell you God loves you. Someone shared a prophetic word. High knee again. Prophetic word for this guy. And he said, you know, I've been struggling with that for 2 years. I feel like God doesn't love me. I said, oh, God loves you. That's why I'm here. And then he said, what about this? He said, what about this? Every time I pray, I see the number 48. I've been seeing it for 2 years, 48. Why 48? I said, oh, that's easy. My son, who's been learning timetables lately, my five-year-old, just interested in it, he said this morning, he asked Daddy a question. What's 4 times 12? And I said, oh, 48. 48. I told him that. He said, 48. Oh, wow. He was just rocked. He was rocked. And when I started sharing about, you know, I said, that means God wants me to, he sent me here to speak to you. And so he was just really becoming very, he said, I feel a shiver. There's like a shiver when you mention that. I feel a shiver. And at the very end, we're about to get on the train. There was this big guy sitting somewhere, walked all the way back. I just took little opportunities here and there. At the very end, I was just about to get on the train, and he was sitting there, and there was a big guy right next door, and the place was full, nowhere to sit. He moved, and we sat right next to him. And that's where I led him into the Lord and released the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And tears began to well up. I was getting embarrassed because the teachers were looking at me, kind of, you know, like, what is going on? I didn't want to, you know, kind of manhandle the situation. He was gloriously touched by the power of the Holy Spirit. Honey, my friends, honey, taste and see that the Lord is good. The question I have for all of us here, which covenant do we live by? Do we live by the old covenant or do we live by the new covenant? It's a good question to ask. Are we living in the old or living in the new? So much of what we don't see is happening. It's being driven along. It has to be driven because we're not seeing the mighty manifestations that Jesus did when he walked the earth. We're not seeing enough of that. So what we do, we're like a Federer. You know, we've got a very powerful tennis arm but a very weak left arm. We've got to develop. We've got to develop and be taught and really understand these covenants, amen? So that we walk in the new covenant. I believe that's a major game changer. Are we seeing tremors or just little trickles? I believe God wants to send a tremor in the nation. Do I hear an amen? A tremor. But we have to start with the little steps that we can. Start prophesying in our life group. Start prophesying to people around. Start getting serious about stewarding our spiritual gifts, walking in the power of God. It will lead to the river of God flowing through us. Amen? John 7:37. If you thirst, any man who thirsts, him come to me and drink. Rivers shall flow. Rivers shall flow. Why? Because we're walking as sons and daughters. We're in freedom in Christ. Praise the Lord. That's my message. I want to impart this. There are Josephs here. If that's you, raise your hand right now. Something speaks to you about that Joseph call to interpret Pharaoh's dream. Anyone here? You want to be someone that touches those people in the marketplace? Raise your hand right now. Josephs. There's one person. Anyone else? Josephs. That's why I believe we're there. We're a Joseph. If you're struggling to see it, I want to encourage you. God wants to impart a gift of faith today. You have faith, but I want to impart the gift of faith, cliff-having faith. If you want to receive prayer, please come. I really feel anointed to pray. God wants to impart a faith that is cliff-hugging, that will help us to really go in places we have not gone to before. Amen? Please come. There's something about the laying on of hands that imparts something. So if you feel to do that, I'd love to pray for you. Bless you.
Thank you, God. Thank you for your goodness today. Thank you for your blessing. You know, the front's still open if we want to receive prayer or receive impartation from Pastor Mark, or if you like prayer as well, please come. Otherwise, this session is officially come to a close. I don't want to